Femi, the only one for me, the God that gives me peace, the one that sets me free.
We give you praise. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. And let God's people shout that amen loud and clear. You may be seated in God's presence. I want to salute Reverend Peter and his wife for taking the pain. It's not easy to bring people like us. You need to have some liver. He got some liver. He got some brutalious, some sagacious mentality. And I appreciate you and your wife. You've done excellently well since I came yesterday. You and your team are taking good care of me. God bless you. God bless your wife. God bless the team. Amen. God bless you all. Celebrate them with a clap offering. Amen. You may be seated. Thank you. Osas, my pilot, and Bernard, God bless you all. In the name of Jesus, thank you so much for taking good care of me. And all of you are cooking. God bless you. Thank you so much. My son Alpha is here, all the way from Dakota. Not Dakota. And he's here also with his friend, another pastor. God bless you. Amen. Another woman of God. God bless you. Thank you for coming. Amen. I'm seeing few partners' faces here. Thank you. I will recognize you at the end of the ministration. And I'm happy you came. And I salute all of you, Mega Fire Ministry. That is the church that is on fire. That is the church that is raining. Let's celebrate Jesus. I want to salute the father of the faith, Apostle Justin Suleiman, my covenant brother for years. Amen and amen. Amen. And that is one of the men in the cutting edge anointing. A man will be in four nations in 1 week. He's not normal. He has an abnormal grace. He terrific schedules. Until I met him, I discovered he said his schedules are acidic. Amen. So we celebrate him. And the coordinator of the Omega Ministries in Georgia at home, Reverend O'Kee. Yes. Let's celebrate in our center. Amen. God's servant. Amen. He also is ministering in Alabama today to be back tomorrow. And that's why he's not here tonight. We celebrate him also. And every one of you, God bless you. In Jesus' name. Take your seat. Tonight is war. Someone shall war. That's why I want red. Someone shall war. War against enemies of your prophecy. Someone say, let there be war.
Let there be war.
I don't like it. Say it louder.
Let there be war.
So I think they should give you a seat somewhere. You push inside so that he can. Okay. You sit on my seat so that you can function properly. You're anointed and promoted.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Someone shall war.
War.
Against enemies of my prophecy. We established yesterday that prophecy is a gift. Prophesying is for every believer. And I chose to use the word prophesying so that everybody can partake. When we talk about prophecy, it's a gift of the Spirit. Anyone can receive from God. The Bible says, despise not to prophesy. We are mandated to prophesy. But hear me, child of God, prophecy is a gift. It can be given to a prophet. It can be given to a believer. But not everybody are gifted with prophecy. But every child of God must be anointed to prophesy. Amen. So, prophecy is not necessarily the description of your past. Prophecy is not necessarily the explanation of your presence. Prophecy is the declaration of your future. It is the what? The declaration of your future. Of what benefit if you describe what I went through yesterday? Of what benefit it is to me if you describe my present condition and cannot give me solution. So prophecy basically is about the prediction, the release of your future. Is somebody hearing what I'm saying? But you see, I want to settle more on prophesying because it benefits you than just talking about prophecy. Is somebody hearing what I'm saying? And I gave you about 10 definitions of prophesying yesterday. How many of you were here yesterday? And I want to progress to give you another 10 definitions of prophesying before we scatter in a thousand directions. Number one for tonight, prophesying is the ability to engage the word of God and get your expectation come to pass by vocalizing the scriptures. By what? Vocalizing the scripture. So prophesying is the ability to engage the word of God and get your expectation met by vocalizing the scripture. That means take the word of God and then look at your condition and speak your expectation over that condition by speaking the word of God on it. That is prophesying. Is somebody hearing what I'm saying? Anyone who does not take the Bible serious can never be an effective believer in the school of prophesying. Hear me, you must take the word of God serious. Because hear me, without the buoyancy of scriptures, you can never be able to prophesy. Because the word of God is the basis for prophesying. Is somebody hearing what I'm saying here? So prophesying, therefore, is the act of enforcing divine promises of God over our lives. And if you don't know those promises, how are you going to prophesy? Number two, prophesying is a God's word backed up by prayer with scriptural involvement. God's word backed up by prayers with scriptural involvement. Number three, prophesying is the opening of a new thing with words of scriptures upon which a man's destiny will hang. Is opening a new thing with words of scriptures upon which a man's destiny will hang. That is prophesying. Number four, prophesying is activating the ministry of the spoken word. Activating the ministry of the spoken word by speaking anointed words that are capable of arresting situations and releasing creative force. I repeat, it is activating the ministry of the spoken word and speaking anointed words that are capable of arresting your situation and releasing creative force. Number five, prophesying is speaking and commanding spiritual forces. Speaking and commanding spiritual forces to go into action, hereby creating divine intention. Whereby you create divine intention, it is speaking and commanding spiritual forces to go into action by declaring and creating divine intentions. Number six, prophesying is calling the new order to replace the old order. Calling a new order to replace the old order by engaging the scriptures. Calling a new order to replace an old order by engaging the scriptures. Number seven, prophesying is speaking into a person's life until the person moves from the frequency of the natural to divine frequency. From natural frequency to divine frequency. Speaking until somebody moves from normal frequency to supernatural frequency. Hear me, child of God, prophesying is the requirement for escaping the troubles of life. Anytime you are surrounded by the troubles of life, you can prophesy your way out of it. You can prophesy your way out of singlehood to manhood. You can prophesy your way out of poverty to prosperity. You can prophesy your way out of calamity, catastrophe, cataclysm to a realm of glory, a realm of sophistication with God, a realm of surplus and abundance. It is possible. So prophesying number eight, therefore, is making declaration concerning a thing under the influence of the Holy Ghost. Making a declaration concerning a theme under the influence of the Holy Ghost. Number nine, prophesying is speaking that backs divine intervention. It is speaking that backs that divine intervention. That is why people like David will look at Goliath. You come to me with your spears. You come to me with your javelin. Then I come to you in the name of the God of Israel, whom thou hast defiled this day. He said, today I will cut off your head, and I will give your carcass to the birds of the earth. When he was saying, I will cut off your head, there was no sword in his hands. The prophet Simon brought sword into the hand of David. Am I talking to somebody here? It is speaking divine intervention over your situation. What is prophesying was what Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego did. They looked at the king and said, we are not careful to answer you in this matter. Our God is able to deliver us. That is prophesying. Speaking in the midst of condition until divine intervention intercept natural occurrences. Is somebody hearing what I'm saying here? I came to announce to somebody, you will not die in your condition. You will not die in that singlehood. You will not die in that battle. I bring you out of every condition. I establish you in relevance. I establish you in dominion. I establish you in breakthrough. Lift up your hand, shout, I prophesy.
I prophesy.
Without divine intervention, by the speakings of Mordecai, Mordecai would have died in the hand of Haman had he not spoken. He said to Esther, who knows if God brought you in such a time as this, that if you will not allow God to use you, he will bring deliverance from another place. That is prophesying. Prophesying, child of God, is calling those things that be not as though they were. Romans chapter 4 verse 17, the scripture said, God who quickened the dead, how does he quicken a dead condition? How does he quicken a dead situation? How does he quicken a dead battles? God who quickened the dead, how does he do it? By calling those things which be not as though they were. God is aware you are single, but you are not to continue to say you are single. Let the redeemer of the Lord say so. God is aware that you are weak, but he said, let the weak say. He didn't say, let the weak say, I am strong, I'm going to be strong. No. God is aware you are weak, but you are to say, I am strong. Let the poor say, I am rich. Can I prophesy to somebody? After today, somebody will prophesy his way out of frustration. Somebody will prophesy his way out of shame. Somebody is walking out of depression. Somebody is walking out of catastrophe. Somebody is walking out of cataclysm. The battles that fought others cannot fight you. The battle that swallow others cannot swallow you. Lift up your hand, shout, divine intervention.
Divine intervention.
Without divine intervention, child of God, many of you would have been vulnerable to the wickedness of men. You'll be vulnerable to satanic antagonism and victimization. But I come in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Receive grace to enter into a realm of intervention. Someone shall prophesy. Take your seat. The realm of the spirit is such that God is not permitted to do anything until somebody says something. The realm of the spirit is regulated by our speakings. Words are so powerful that they are the currency of transaction in the spirit realm. If you are a spiritual man and you don't have two things, the spiritual realm will be against you. The spiritual realm is traded by two things, words and blood. If you have no blood to offer spiritually and you have no words to speak, you have no future to secure. That's why every religion is loaded with speakings. Islam is known with speakings. Meet Hindus, they are known for speakings. Even Catholics, they are known for speakings. Their rosary is for enchantment. They chant and chant. Meet the Muslim man, his chant speed is for chanting. He begins to chant. When he chant and chant and chant, when he get to the 10,000 times of chanting, spirits go into air that begin to desire blood. Is somebody hearing what I'm saying here? Yes, Christianity also is for chanting. If you don't know how to chant as a Christian, you'll be wasted. Another one for Christianity is confession. The faith, the confession. If you don't know how to speak, you'll be buried. That's why Hosea chapter 14 verse 2 said, when you go before the Lord, take words. Take words. Don't carry your makeup there. Don't carry your head gear there. Don't carry your shape and catwalk in there. He said, don't carry your handsome face there, your sideburns. He said, when you go before the Lord, take words.
take words and talk to the Lord and say unto him, if you have nothing to say, heaven has nothing to give to you. So to remain an active participant in the game of life, you must be an active speaker. To remain an active participant in the game of life, you must be an active speaker. To go on living, you must go on speaking. No battle ceases in the realm of the spirit until sufficient declaration is made. No battle ceases in the realm of the spirit until sufficient declaration is made. Hear me, sir. If you are not a man that declares, you will remain a victim in this life. Child of God, show me a man who speaks, I show you a man who has advantage.
Amen.
I hear people say, I'm praying in my heart. That's why your life is like that. Everybody is voicing out. Keto koto bakata. Breketo sabreya takapura gadas. And the one that can't speak in tongues is quoting scripture. It is written. It is written. You stand like a locomotive engine that has no engine. Pray now. I'm praying in my heart. And in the true sense, you are not praying your heart. Because even your heart, if it does not speak words, it cannot. Because God is a designer of the thoughts. The word of God is quick and sharper, piercing to the divine asunder of the bones and the marrow. He's the designer of the thoughts.
Yes, yes, yes.
So the word of God also can judge your thoughts.
My God.
That's why to him that is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that you think or ask. God goes beyond what you think or ask. My friend, if your life is dying, don't keep quiet. Job 13:19, Job said, if I hold my tongue, I will give up the ghost. If I keep quiet, I will be buried. My friend, I pray for you. Before the witches in your village bury you, receive grace to speak. Before poverty in your family swallow your future, receive grace to speak. Don't keep quiet when the enemy is against your life. Who is he that will plead for me? For now, if I hold my tongue, I will give up the ghost. If I keep quiet, they will bury me. If I keep silence, they will bury me. Lift up your hands, shout, I will speak. Shout, he said, I will prophesy. Can I talk to somebody here? Receive grace to prophesy to your business, to prophesy to your marriage, to prophesy to your ministry, prophesy to your relationship, prophesy to the womb of your wife, prophesy to your kitchen, prophesy to your wardrobe, prophesy to your bank account, prophesy to your checkbook. Begin to declare until you see it. Elijah said the other day, I hear the sound of the abundance of rain. And for rain to be visible, he had to put his head between his knees and prophesy and speak seven times until a hand came out from the cloud. Elijah said, that is enough. I came to Atlanta to prophesy to somebody. You are overdue for a miracle. You are overdue for a testimony. I came to prophesy you into your dreams, into your expectation, into your desire. No power can stop your future. The devil is a liar. If God be for us, who can be against us? If God is on your side, power is on your side. Favor is on your side. Anointing is on your side. Lift your legs on fire. Lift your hands on fire. Somebody shall fire, yeah. Give somebody high five, say, I will talk. Someone say, I will talk. Hear me. Anytime, take your seat, God will change your condition, he will give you a word.
Amen.
Anytime God will change your condition, he will give you a word.
Amen.
Sir, prophetic assets are created by words. Hear me. Even ordinary words are powerfully charged. I'm telling you. Words alone, ordinary words that men speak. By a single conversation, Abigail moved from a wife of a fool to a wife of a general. By talking. By talking. So women don't know how to talk. The most powerful women on earth are those who use their words well. When Abigail apprehended a general ready to shed blood, he had a battalion of army ready to kill. When Abigail spoke to David, he laid down his weapons. When Abigail spoke to David, he turned a battalion back to the barracks without shedding a blood. When David went home, he said, what was those, that woman saying to me that made me change my mind? He desired to have her. And the other day he heard that the woman's husband have died. He applied immediately. So even second hand has more value than tear rubber. A second hand lady had more value than a tear rubber. A tear rubber that doesn't know how to talk. Some women, all they say is to bring the devil out of their husband. You call yourself a man. They are calling men, even you are a monk. They are counting meat in the pot, but Moses is number 15. That's how you are describing your husband. He has lost grace to fight. But as a way you speak to a man, he charges up. Words are powerful. They are spirits. The words that I speak unto you, they are spirits and they are life. Don't joke with words. Be careful how you talk. Because what reveals passions? What creates relationship? I'm telling you. A small word can destroy a relationship. And a small word can build a relationship. Words. God loves words so much that he called himself the word. That is a level at which he was passionate with words. So anytime God sees a man who knows how to talk, he's his friend. Don't come, Father, you know. You know that I know that you know. You know what is in my heart. You will die there. You will die there. But when you stand up and say, it is written, it is written, it is written, it is written, based on this, by reason of these immutable scriptures, I put to rest this matter. Even angels operate by words. Say, bless you, all his angel, who has said his strength, hearkening to the voice of his command. So angels hear words. They have no respect for your fine face if you cannot have words. There are many people whose life have cheated because they don't know how to speak. So hear me, child of God. You cannot be an effective prophesier until you are word loaded. You are scripturally loaded, like a loaded machine gun. At the slightest provocation, you unleash. Receive capacity to carry the word of God in your spirit. Receive capacity to build word in your spirit. In the mighty name of Jesus. The Bible says, how forcible are right words. How forcible are right words. See some ladies, fine face, but their words are poisonous. So when the man communicates with them in 5 minutes, he changes his mind. There is evil in the tongue. He cannot sustain his life and his future. But hear me, sir. Anytime you have the word of God is pregnant with hope. The word of God. The word of God can feed your future in times of famine. The word of God, if you have it, sir, it can encourage you in your wilderness. The word of God, if you have it, sir, he will see you through despite the aggression of the word of God, or despite the aggression of life. He said he watches over his word to perform it. He's magnify his word more than his name. Hallelujah. That means God said, put me and put my word, forget me and see my word. My word has more value than my name. And he said he watches over his word. He stands upon the face of the earth looking for who has word. When he finds a man in Atlanta who has word and is speaking, he makes sure that that word has effect. And the word is a working spirit. So it's my word that goeth out of my mouth. It shall not return. So the word of God is a mobile answer. Is somebody hearing what I'm saying here? Am I talking to somebody here? It goeth out. It does not return until it accomplishes the purpose. Means prophecy potent is the word in the prophecy.
My God.
The word of God wrapped up in your prophetic declarations.
My God.
That's why a man will say, tomorrow by this time.
My God, my God, my God.
Tomorrow by this time. One man doubted. He said, you will see, but you will not eat.
My God, my God.
He died in the gate of abundance.
My God.
Because he never believed in abundance. He spoke against the word that came. So he perished. He perished. Prophecy can kill your enemies before you meet them. If you know how to prophesy. Can I prophesy to somebody? There is a word over your condition. There is a word over your situation. From today, may the word of God
divine expression in your life. May your destiny break forth on every side. Whatever swallow your glory is coming down for your sake. Lift up your hands, say, Lord, there is a word over my life. I will not give up until my word comes to pass. Until my word comes to pass.
So the word of God, therefore, is God's prophecy in print. The word of God is God's prophecy in print. So when you have the word of God, you are pregnant with prophetic words.
My God.
When you have the word of God, child of God, you are pregnant with prophetic bullets. When you have the word of God, child of God, you are pregnant with hope. The word of God, child of God, is what commands the attention of God. The word of God, child of God, is the same word of prophecy. It's the same word of prophecy. When you have the word of God, child of God, the tools for prophesying becomes a reality.
Yes.
This generation is more crazy for gift than the word.
Yes.
That's why we have no debts.
Yes.
That's why little pressures of life, they just shake us.
Yes.
We just lose appetite for prayers. We lose appetite for serving God because we allow our condition to move us. Meanwhile, we have to change our condition. The Bible says he staggered not at the promise of God through unbelief. He was strong in faith, giving glory to God. And it was counted unto him. It was counted unto him for righteousness. So he obtained the promise. He staggered not at the word of God. You cannot stagger. Hear me, the greatest pain of God is to be doubted. The greatest joy of God is to be believed. Hear me, I hear me well. I have told you yesterday, there are three things if you have, prophecy becomes a reality. Number one, the word of God. Number two, you must have a belief system.
Yes, yes, yes.
And number three, you must have a company of prophets. Because company of prophets guarantee things that naturally you cannot. When Saul joined himself with the company of prophets, he began to prophesy. Prophetic companies are very contagious, more contagious than chicken pox. Prophetic company have a way of shifting the word of God into reality in your life. Today I declare with my eyes open, the word of God is coming real in your life. You can speak to dead womb and they come alive. The word of God, the word of God, the word of God, the word of God. My friend was a Muslim, Audu by name, and then a lady. We got her saved from the street, a prostitute. She got her saved and she got saved and she was serving God for 3 years. And Audi, when he got born again, he said he likes the lady. I said, why not? Go ahead. And the lady came to him and said, I like you, but I can't marry you. Why? He said, I have no womb. Someone say, no womb.
No.
I have no womb. My womb has been removed. I can never bear a child. So he showed him her scan. How the womb has been removed. How you looked at it, he came to me and he said, man of God, what do you think we should do? I said, if you love her enough, the word of God can create wombs.
Amen.
The word of God can create wombs.
Amen.
If you love her enough, that is all we need.
Yes, Jesus.
I have married 28 HIV people that have no HIV.
My God, my God.
Lay hands on them, give back to children that have no HIV. Up to tomorrow. The word of God. So he said, it's ready. I said, let's help her. We held hand, I lay my hands on her womb.
My God.
I command a new baby, a new womb.
My God.
And I prophesied. And I joined the wedding. That month, she missed her period. She downloaded a baby boy. Right now, she has 4 children. Chopping life with 35 fingers. She has 10 fingers. She borrowed the fingers of her enemies. And add to her own. I eat life with 35 fingers. He collect those things that be not as though they were. You can call your money. I don't care how long you've been looking for your papers. In 2 days, it can manifest. Somebody can step into his testimony between now and the next 48 hours. You can be a millionaire within 7 days. The word of God, the word of God. Heaven and earth shall pass away, but the word of the Lord abideth forever.
Amen.
I don't know who you are. I don't know what you know about Christianity. I don't know the women of God you met that made you doubt God. But today, I came with a different grace. You must believe God.
Amen.
You have no business being a Christian if you can't believe the word of God.
Amen.
He that cometh to God must believe. It is not optional.
Yes.
It's a must. There's no back door, no exit door. Must believe that he is. And that he is a rewarder. And if you don't believe, don't come. If you must come, come believe it. And if you can't believe, don't come.
Jesus.
There's an option for how you come.
God.
How you come to his presence matters to God. God doesn't want you to come here and be neutral. Neutrality in the kingdom is a curse. To come here without expectation is a curse. Come here because something must change. Come here because something must move. Come here because something must shift. To see God with an ordinary eyes is a curse. It's a curse. To appear here with nothing in your heart is a curse. Don't come if you can't believe. And if you want to come, come believe. He that cometh must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder. Believe this word of your prophecy. I don't know who you are, but along the round, along the lane, when you became born again, you were carrying prophecy. Because every child of God is a potential prophecy carrier. And that prophecy through the word I preach, the word of God I preach from your churches and from this altar, or a prophetic word, or you were handpicked and spoken detailing with dates, or that God told you to open the scripture, he wants to talk to you, and your eyes fell into a truth in the scripture, and light shoot out of that word. The word, the spirit of God came out of the black print of scriptures and begin to walk in your heart, and you begin to feel some sense of restlessness, and you begin to personalize that word. Hear me, that word became individualistic for you, and you know it is your word. The Bible says, whose feet they hot in iron. He was led in fetters until his word came. When the word comes, no hell can keep you. The Bible says it was not possible for hell to keep him. After today, I declare, poverty will not be able to keep you. Ancestral bondage will not be able to keep you. Generational curse will not be able to keep you. The powers in your father's house will not be able to keep you. This is your night.
Amen.
This is your night.
Amen.
I don't like your amen. I said, this is your night.
Amen.
Take your seat. So prophesying number 10 is the act of communicating the word of prophecy. It has to do with the believer's daily word of confession. The act of communicating the word of prophecy. Speaking it, speaking it, speaking it, speaking it until you see it. Speaking it until you see it. Can I prophesy to somebody here? From today, with my eyes open, every word you are carrying, I came so that it will be a reality here. And the word became flesh and dwell among us. The word tonight shall become car.
Amen.
Shall become a house.
Amen.
Shall become employment.
Amen.
Shall become a baby.
Amen.
It shall become marriage.
Amen.
It shall become breakthroughs. It shall become papers.
Amen.
Somebody say it shall become.
Amen.
Shout it louder.
Amen.
One more time.
Amen.
For the last time.
Amen.
Take your seat. Revelation chapter 12. Let's get to the cruise of today's service. The core matter. I say all this. I say this now. I said everything I said in the last 15 to 20 minutes just to begin the message now. Revelation chapter 12 and verse 7. Revelation 12, get it for us on the screen. Shall we read it together? I want to go.
And there was war in heaven.
Yeah?
Michael and his angels fought against the dragon.
And the dragon. Continue to verse 8 and 9. And what?
Prevail not. Neither was their place found any more in heaven.
Verse 11.
And the great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil and Satan, which deceived the whole world.
Yes.
He was cast out into the earth, and his angels were cast out with him.
How did they cast him out? Verse 11. Verse 11. How did they cast him out?
And they overcome him by the blood of the Lamb and by the words of their testimony. And they love not their lives unto death.
Lift up your hands and prophesy.
Yes, Jesus.
Every war against your prophecy,
hey.
It scatters now.
Amen.
Take your seat. Heaven is not just the throne room of God. Heaven is not just the base of angels. Heaven is the manufacturing factory where prophecy originates. Heaven is the manufacturing factory
where prophecy originates. The destiny of man is decided in heaven, but implemented on earth. The destiny of man is formed in heaven, but coupled here on earth. So Satan took war to heaven. Why heaven? Satan took war to the command and center of control of God. Why? Satan took war to the source and the fountain of our future. Because our future is heaven. All this laboring to serve God is to end in heaven. All this serving God is to end in heaven. Satan took battle to our destination.
My God.
He took war to our future.
My God.
Heaven is a factory where earth is the showroom. Satan decided to fight the factory. But the angels were deployed to resist the devil. Because if the factory of prophecy is destroyed, the showroom will have nothing to offer. You only showcase anything in the showroom that the factory has manufactured. Follow me because I'm getting somewhere. Hear me, as he was cast down, he saw that he could no longer fight the factory. He decided to fight the showroom. But that devil is a liar.
Amen.
If you destroy the showroom, factory will send another one.
Yes.
That is why I know that no matter what the devil has destroyed, it can be repaired.
Amen.
No matter what the devil took from the showroom, the factories will replace it.
Amen.
That's why I know new organs can be replaced. That's why I know new relationships can be replaced. That's why I know that new papers can be given. That's why I know that mercy can be shown. That's why I know that second chance can be given to someone. That is why I know that heaven can replicate, duplicate, and repair what the enemy has destroyed. And that is why I know that condition, you won't die like that. Heaven will repair your life.
Amen.
Yes, if Satan is attacking you, my friend, that's just a showroom.
Yes, uh-huh. Yes.
He has no access to the factory.
Yes.
The factory will still send.
My God.
If anything goes wrong with your Mercedes, there's a factory called Mercedes Factory.
My God.
They will send a new parts.
Yes.
Am I right?
Yes.
If your gearbox is not working, they will send new gearbox.
Yes.
Hey, am I talking to somebody here? If your alternator is not working, they send a new alternator. Because a factory, if you destroy the factory, it means the showroom may not have delivery. So, heaven is where prophecy originates.
My God.
And everyone here rides on the wings of prophecy.
Yes.
It was prophecy that necessitated your arrival.
Yes.
God will never bring you into fruition until he spoke.
My God.
Let us make man. You're a product of prophecy.
Yes.
A product of prophecy.
Yes.
So whatever goes wrong with your life right now, we can refix it.
Amen.
Did you hear what I said? I said you can refix it. I said you can refix it. There's a member of mine, he's doing Bible school right now. Right now, there's August special going on. And the man came to Bible school last year. And he's 26 years without a child. Kilabakasko brothers. As I was preaching, I turned. And I said, that man there, stand up. And I saw that your wife is barren for years. He said, yes, sir. How long is it, 26 years? The whole church shouted, woo, 26. You are married to one woman for 26 years, no child. He said, yes. I said, the problem is not child. The doctor said it can never be possible. He said, yes. I said, as I'm talking right now, an angel has been released from the service.
Amen.
He has put a new uterus in your wife and a new egg in your wife. And right now, as I'm talking, your wife is pregnant.
Amen.
Sir, as I am talking right now, this woman is on the ninth month.
Lodation.
Ninth month. 26 years of barrenness, broken cheaply. That is the word of the Lord. It can never fail. Prophecy is a dangerous thing. Our present chief of defense staff is a four-star general. I beat him in service. Stand there, I said, general, there, stand up. He said, I saw that they put four stars on your shoulder and they gave you the highest seat in the Nigerian military. And I brought him out, pour oil until he could not see. Empty a whole 3 bottles. Carry him, put on my chair. He sat there.
The enemy saw the prophecy. He fought. The next thing is 4 days after, they transferred him to a place called Mina. In Nigerian history, if they transfer you to Mina, you're on your way out of the military since 1963 till date. He is the only man that went there and returned.
Amen.
Prophecy is a powerful thing.
Amen.
When I prophesied the following Sunday, I was preaching. I saw this general was not answering amen. Nothing. So after service, I was curious. I said, "General, can you see me?" He came. So he said, "Sir, he transferred me to Mina." I said, "Why Mina?" I said, "It's not where they transfer Okumba that retired." He says, "They're not in the transfer." So he says, "They take you there." He says, "Sir, you know, once a man gets there, anytime they post you there, he knows you're an enemy of the chief. And therefore, he wants you out of the system." So I'm on my way out. Immediately, I sat there. I said, "God, did you speak or you didn't speak?" Now, the enemy has done damage to prophecy. I heard a voice say, "It's not your word, it's his word." I said, "General, come back." I pour oil. I said, "See now, thus says the Lord, you shall be the number one in the military." I pour oil. I'm talking about in the midst of impossible.
Yes, my God.
I say, "Sir, you go to Mina, but 3 hours distance from Abuja." I said, "Be coming to service every Sunday." That's what he was doing for 2 years. I didn't look at him. I was preaching. 2 years in Mina. And you can't stay there for 2 months in Mina. You're going on retirement. But he stayed there for 2 years. He was looking at me. I'll look at him. I'll turn my face. I said, "I didn't see. I'll be prophesying." The week the thing will happen, the Lord told me, "Son, it's time to activate his prophecy." He came to church. I said, "Sir, come here. Did you remember what God said 2 years ago and you were taken to me?" And I said, "Yes, sir." I said, "Kneel down." The Lord said, "The time has come."
My God.
That is why anytime God will leave people, I have always prayed, "Lord, always use me when it is time for people. Don't use me when it's not their time." If I enter any church, it means it is their time.
Amen.
Their season has come.
Amen.
Anointed him that Sunday. Poured the oil till he couldn't see him. On Wednesday, they announced his name. He never believed. He didn't lobby. Everybody lobbied to be the chief of defense staff. He didn't. He was there. Bam! His name came out. The man said, "He will not sit on that seat till I come." Anointed him. He gathered 75 generals. He said, "That is the man that prophesied. If you want help, let him pray for you." All of them went on their knees and started laying hands on them. Shakwa, Leba, I said, "You will remain. You will be sent away. You will be sent away." And everyone I say will be sent, we are sent. The ones I say you will remain, you will remain. And I kept saying that. I said, "You will remain, you will be sent away." I didn't know, I only prophesied. And the same president now awarded him 2 ranks higher. He was a 2-star. They made him 4-star, full-star general. Right now, he's still there for 5 years, no movement. The highest staying chief of defense in the history of Nigeria. You don't stay more than 1 year, 6 months. But he's there for about 5 years. A new regime has come. They are still maintaining the power of prophecy.
Amen.
Before I came here, 2 days before, I said, "Do you want to remain or I should remove you?" He said, "Anything the Lord said." I said, "We'll keep him for some time." The word of God is strong. Is strong. And God showed me that many of you here are carrying prophecies.
Yes.
And your prophetic word shall come to pass.
Yes.
I don't like that name, and I say it shall come to pass.
Yes.
I say it shall come to pass.
Yes.
Lift up your hands, say, "My prophetic word must come to pass."
Now.
Take your seat. There are forces that fight our prophetic word. Our prophecy. Number one force is contrary voices. Somebody say contrary voices.
Contrary voices.
Let me hear you shout it louder.
Contrary voices.
One more time.
Contrary voices.
These are voices of doubts and arguments. They are voices of what?
Doubts
and arguments. Spoken to counteract the word of God in your life.
Yes.
They are voice of doubts.
Yes.
They are voice of arguments. They cast aspersion against the credibility and the reliability of God's word. They make you doubt the word of God. It's a contrary voice.
Yes, Lord.
When they said, you shall give back to a child by this time, the voice will speak like he spoke to Sarah. How can this thing be? It seems that I am very old. Will my husband ever have pleasure in me? That is Genesis chapter 18. And let's start from verse 12. Put it for me. Verse 12. Sarah began to speak. That is a voice, the contrary voice. When contrary voice in operation is very dangerous. Therefore, Sarah laughed within herself, saying, after I am once old, shall I have pleasure? My Lord being old also, menopause raised to power too. That is Sarah. Am I talking? This one is not even menopause. It's menostop. This one, it has stopped. After the man, look at the next verse. The next verse, verse 3. It was a voice of contrary voice speaking. And the Lord said to Abraham, wherefore did Sarah laugh, saying, shall I of surety bear a child which I am old? Why is Sarah doubting and obeying contrary voice? Verse 14, he said, is there anything too hard for the Lord? At the appointed time, I will return unto her according to the time of life, and Sarah shall have a child.
Yes, Lord. My God.
Have you ever doubted God before? If you doubt God, you will pay. Every one day you doubt God, you pay with 1 year. If you doubt God on Monday, God will teach you lesson for 1 year. Many of you are repeating class. Let me warn you. Anybody who doubts God's word, anybody who does not believe God's word, will go to hell. We are sorcerers, homongers. Homongers means gays. And liars go to hell. You that doubt God's word and doubt your prophecy, you will go to hell. Revelation 21 verse 8. The Bible says, and the fearful and the unbelieving. The unbelieving. These are people who believe, who are supposed to be believers. The unbelieving and the abominable and the murderers and the homongers and the sorcerers and the idolaters. All liars shall have their part in the lake which burneth with fire and brimstone, which is the second death.
Yes, Lord Jesus.
If you doubt God's word, you will go to hell. You will go to hell.
Amen.
Numbers chapter 14 and verse 30. Look at that scripture. When they came, the Bible said in Numbers 13 verse 27, they said, we searched the land, and indeed it's a land that flows with meat and honey. This is the fruit. They produce the evidence. But they doubted it. They said, wherefore we say we came to the land without thou sending us, and surely it flows with meat and honey. This is the fruit. That means there's an evidence that our prophecy is true. It can come to pass. And look at what they did. Chapter 14 and verse 30, they doubted the word. Contrary voice. Contrary voice is a very wicked voice.
Yes.
It fights our word, fights our prophecy. Child of God, contrary voice, the reason why you've been joyful 10 years, there's no reflection of what you confess. He said, doubtless, you have not come into the land concerning which I swear to you to dwell in. Say Caleb, the son of Jephunneh, and Joshua, the son of Nun. Verse 31, he said, but your little ones, which you said should be a prey, then will I bring in, and they shall know the land which you have despised. You despised your prophecy with your contrary voice. By obeying contrary voice. Verse 32. What did God say to them? He said, for as for you, your carcass, they shall fall in this wilderness. Death is for every man. You
my
die
God,
when you doubt God.
God.
Any day you doubt God, death sets in.
Yes, yes.
In your
yes,
life.
Yes, yes.
I came with a strong message.
Yes.
I came because we are in a days where believers doubt God. Look at the scripture. Continue, sir. Verse 31 say, your children shall wander in this wilderness for 40 years and bear your wonder. And your carcass shall be wasted in the wilderness. Verse 34, he said, after the numbers of the days which you search the land, even 40 days, each day for 1 year, you will bear your iniquity. And 40 years, you shall know my breach of promise. You search the land for 40 days, and I will punish you for 40 years. Each day for 1 year.
My God.
You will go around till I waste all of you. All of you will die. You won't enter.
My God.
You will not enter your prophecy because you doubted the reality of your prophecy. How do I know you doubt God's word? Father, are you still on the throne? Father, where are thou? Why should you be watching me and be hidden and laughing at me? My friend, are you reporting all you are praying? What are you talking about? God expects you to stand up and say, it is written, it is written, it is written. Yes. The more the enemy press on you, the more you prophesy.
Yes, Jesus.
Pastor, Papa, I don't understand. I am sick. I don't know. This is my sickness. I don't know what to do. Be healed. Receive the power of God. Beg. You fall on the guy. You rotate like a locomotive engine. You stand up from the ground. He said, Papa, like I was saying, this is my sickness. The question is, I am asking you. I just finished prayer. Now you came back again to say, this is my sickness. Are you caused? That is why you can be blessed. But when I say, go, it is well. It is well. That's all. And you get your manifestation.
Yes.
You must be aggressive in getting the manifestation,
yes,
God.
Jesus.
Like the other day, I finished this kind of preaching. One of my daughters just stood on the road and blocked me. I said, what's wrong with you? Did you take any drugs? He said, no, sir. He said, give me a chance. He said, no, sir, you're not going. The protocols wanted to clear her. I said, protocol, leave her. The road is big. I'll follow here. When I wanted to go this way, she moved. I wanted to go that way. She moved. I said, what's wrong with you? Don't you know your pastor is fasting? He said, yes, say, release my husband, otherwise you won't move an inch. I said, I'm not holding your husband. He said, you said that the anointing I need is in my man of God. The prophetic word over my life is in my man of God. So since you are my man of God, release it now. If you don't release my husband, you will marry me today. When I heard marry me, I said, kneel down. I spoke in tongues in capital letters. Vembrundo Gushi, Frigito, Kalatas, Prayas. Father! Give this lady seven husbands at once. That she will learn not to attack a man of God. When she was shouting, amen, I have passed and gone. 2 weeks after, 10 men came to marry her. She called me and said, Papa, I'm dead. I said, no, you are alive. She said, 10 at once. I said, so if then come, what is, are you a fool? Choose one. He said, you don't understand. All of them look alike. So I said, bring their names for me here. She brought the names. I said, kneel down. I said, Father, make it 15. That she will learn not to attack a man. She said, hey, Salubu, I'm dead. I said, get out of my office. Forever attacking my anointing, leave my office now. 15. By the time 1 month, 2 weeks, she called me from the airport, said, Papa, I bought a ticket. I'm on my way. I'm on the run. Your child is on the run. Run, where are you running? He said, you are 17 now. I'm dead. I don't know which trouble I brought on my life. I am running before they will kill me here. I said, come back. Let me choose one. He said, no, sir. You will increase it. I said, no, we increase it. So she managed and took steps like a Nicodemus. I entered my office. I wanted to say, Papa, I said, no, don't worry, I'm not going to increase it. I said, Linda, write their name, she wrote 17. Man, where were they? For 10 years she was looking for something. Because a man needs to call them by the word. I call your money. I call your favor. I call your promotion. I call your blessings. I call your lifting. You can answer, I receive it. Take your seat. So guess what, sir? I saw the 17 names, so I spoke in tongues in capital letter. Mom wrote us, fire. Waladadosa, fire. Njintu managalaba, fire. Nyando shanto nyandano monolos, fire. Nyando nyando shanto nyandano. Marry this one. Today, she's married, chopping life with 35 fingers. And God have changed her life. If she does not insist on her prophetic word,
yes,
Lord. She will remain a victim.
Yes, Lord.
Please, I beg you, every voice of doubt and argument, I silence it in the name of Jesus. Anything that makes you question the sincerity of God's word and the sincerity of God's plans for your life, I attack that spirit. Anytime the devil comes, he comes for your prophecy. Satan doesn't come because your name is Shokoroko Bangosha or your name is Ekeleton Dr. Manokrof. No. The devil comes because of the word over your life.
Yes.
When he showed up in the garden, he said, did God say? It's after what God said. If you know what God said, you put him out.
Yes.
But if you don't know what God said, you remain a victim. Did God say? And the man who God spoke to wasn't there. The woman who God didn't speak to was the woman trying to rehearse. When information passed from one person to another, it cannot be original.
Yes.
And so she didn't know exactly what God said. And before you know, power was exchanged. And the woman lost everything because a contrary voice became a force that attacked their prophecy. Now let me talk to you. Contrary voice attacks in the midst of the wheat. The Bible says a man sowed tares in Matthew 13. And an enemy came in the night. A man sowed wheat. And an enemy came in the night and sowed tares. What is the purpose of the tires? To swallow the wheat. What is the purpose of contrary voice? To swallow your original voice. Because in the realm of the spirit, voice must speak. Voice makes spiritual sounds. Voices are spirits. Hear me? The atmosphere we carry is predicated by the voice that is deployed over our atmosphere. And if what is on your atmosphere is the voice of contrary, hear me, sir, you can't escape contrary manifestations. Where there are contrary voices, contrary manifestations become inevitable. Hear me? Any man under the influences of contrary voices cannot escape satanic pursuit. Satan pursues people whenever they carry contrary voice.
My God.
I pray for you. Every contrary voice that I see among your wheat, I command that voice to be uprooted in the name of Jesus. Contrary voice of judgment. Contrary voice of ancestral bondage. Contrary voice of demonic antagonisms. I command them broken. Lift up your hands. Any power. Say no to my prophecy.
Any voice.
Say no to my prophetic word. You are a liar. What are you waiting for? Catch fire. Drop your hand and pray that prayer. Catch fire. One more prayer. Lift up your voice. Say any voice.
Calling
against my prophecy. In the court of Satan. What are you waiting for? Silence by fire. Any voice. Calling against, walking and speaking against. Any voice. Speaking against my prophetic word. In the court of Satan. In the court of Satan. Who is that? I pray for you. Every delay in your life. Every delay in your life. I destroy that spirit of delay. I've seen somebody. Thank you, Jesus. Benedict. Who is that? I'm seeing a voodoo operation that looks like witchcraft from Caribbean. Fighting your marriage. Fighting your prophetic word. And I'm seeing a man from Nigeria by your side. Where are you from? Bahamas, the Caribbean. Who is he to you? Who is this person to you?
There's a lot of wicked spirit of scattering. Scattering. Pray very well. I want to say something, but I don't know if I'm led to sing before everybody. That will sing to pray for you. Let me make your prophecy private. There's something I'm seeing. Every voodoo. When there's a combination of voodoo and witchcraft, it's a wicked attack. Where are you from, sir? Nigeria. Jesus. The powers that are working against your destiny both. Break. 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 Break.
Amen.
You have a doubt about this young man, but the Lord says, you tell you don't doubt. I'll tell you something. Look at me. The spell is broken. Number two, enemy of your prophecy. I'll give you three. Out of 12, I'll give you three. Tomorrow morning, we're entering some rain. His operation, kill tomorrow. Arise and kill. That's my last service tomorrow morning. Today is a blood battle. I hope you came with your red drinks. No, you don't have it, somebody will blow you. Today, something will happen here. Some of you angels will live here and go to your cities and go to your villages. You didn't hear what I said. They will go to your villages and to your city. There will be such a dimension of oppressions that will bury some forces that has fought you over the years. In the mighty name of Jesus. I'm seeing an angel running. I see him running. My God, look at the speed this angel is running. I see him running. Running. I see him enter Cameroon. I see him go to a cemetery. I'm hearing, break her destiny out in Chaco. In Chaco. Dancing.
Oh, Jesus.
Dancing in Chaco. He said, I should ask Delphine, who is Angeline? Angeline, I'm seeing a lot of manipulations going on. I see the spirit of necromancer. They bury the glory of these ladies in a grave. I enter that grave with the angels. I dig out that grave. I dig out that grave. I carry back your glory. I return it back to you. Number two enemy I want to deal with, because I have three to handle in this service. Number two enemy is unbroken curses. Someone say unbroken curses. I'm not talking about curses. I'm talking about curses that are not broken. Stretch your hand towards my light. Towards my direction. Every negative force that is antithetical to prophetic declarations, I command that force destroy. Let me hear that amen like a thunder. Unbroken curses can mess and interfere with our prophetic destiny. When curses are not broken, life are not fulfilled.
When curses are not broken, life is not fulfilled. Follow me. Curses create enabling environment for failure, stagnation, and limitation to strive. I'm telling you. Hear me well. Curses are satanic magnets. They draw evil occurrence towards a man. And repetitive battles are seen in the life of a man when curses are not broken. They make a man's life vital for attack. They make a man's life a fertilizer for adversity. Hear me, child of God. When your life is under unbroken curse, your life becomes a landing place for satanic assault. It becomes a landing ground for satanic maneuvers. And it becomes a landing ground for ascending and descending of evils. All kinds of evils men see in their life because of unbroken curses. Let me tell you something. In Genesis 49 verse 1 to 4, we saw that Reuben was carrying prophecy. But because of curses that was not broken, Reuben reduced to nothing. And Jacob called all his sons and said, gather yourself together. I may tell you that which shall befall you in the latter days. Somebody say that is prophecy. And then when they gather themselves, he said, gather yourself together. And here you sons of Jacob, hearken to me, your father. Verse 3 continues, sir. He looked at him, he said, Reuben. He said, daddy. He said, you are my firstborn. He said, correct. You are my might. He said, correct. You are the beginning of my strength. Correct. By prophecy, you are the excellency of dignity. Amen. By prophecy, you are the excellency of power. That is who you are. That is what you are supposed to be. And he looked at him in verse 4. He said, but I place a curse. Prophecy derailed. Prophecy denied. Prophecy brought to a halt. But unstable as water. You will not, your life will be crooked. You will never be straight. You went to my bed, you defied my wife. He said, from today, a vagabondic spirit takes over you, a monkeyous spirit. You've been moving around like a rolling stone without moisture. Sir, when that curse landed on Reuben, prophecy detained. 200 years after, Moses gathered the children to bless them. When he saw Reuben, he started crying. Reuben were looking like HIV patients, Somalian refugees. They were looking pinjomic, microscopic, and myopic. They were looking pathetic. Their light had been brought under obscure darkness. Even though he was a firstborn, his tribe shrinked. Reuben's generation reduced in number, they reduced in influence. I'm telling you. They became casualty of all manner of misfortune and aggressions. They were looking like Lilliputian. Very, very minute, inconsequential. When Moses saw the first tribe, he cried, oh, that Reuben may live and not die, and that his men may not be few. He broke the curse. Stretch your hand towards me. Anything that followed you from Africa, from the Caribbean, from Asia, from any part of America and Europe, wherever you came to settle here, whatever pursue you to limit your influence and productivity, today I stand in my office as a prophet. It doesn't matter who curse you. It doesn't matter where it's coming from. Whether it's from your father or from your client or from your tribe or from a wicked priest, evil voodoo, or a sangoma, or a true priest, or an alpha, or a mala, or a soothsayer, or an enchanter, or a necromancer, or a diviner, or an invoker of darkness, wherever they come from to limit your influence and productivity, I, Joshua Talina, by the mantle of my mandate, I break that curse. A church of 10,000.
and I beat the man. I said, you are under a curse. Somebody summoned you in the altar of Hindu and placed a curse, and I called the name of the goddess. It's a god that weep. It's a god that weep. In, you know, India, they have over 33 million gods. So one of the gods is uses koboko. He weeps. You will see him. He's a dragon with koboko in his hands. And they summon you, and everything is not working. I said, there's a property. You've been trying to sell the property for 28 years. He said, yes. And nobody has been able to price the property. He said, yes. I said, they place a curse on that place. I took the blood. I pour on the ground. I said, pour on the land. He pour on the land. I said, the curse is broken. I left India on Monday. They sold the property on Wednesday.
Wow.
After 28 years. The man began to prosper, and he insisted through the man of God that $10,000 must be sent to me. Even when he paid his tithe in one point something million dollars, he still gave the man of God $10,000. He sent to that Nigerian pastor, because this thing I could not explain. From that day, his doors opened. His three children are in Canada. They could not travel. Doors were shut. Many of you behind this physical life, there is something mysteriously frustrating you. Others came here, got their papers. You are here 10 years, 17 years. I shed tears last week when they brought back some Nigerian, one from America with his family, 17 years, no papers. Brought back home with only a bag. He worked at the airport on the national television, and I shook my head on broken guests. My friend, the law of this country is not your problem. It is what is pursuing you. Because when you carry God, laws can be suspended. Protocols can be broken. Am I talking to somebody here? I'm seeing three spirits from the sea. Entered Osa's shop. I'm seeing a shop of cars. Three spirits from the sea were invoked to swallow his car business. Young man, if I be a man of God, I've been preaching for 32 years. I may look fresh and young, but listen, my nation has regard for me. There's no major altar I have not preached in Nigeria. No major altar. There's no continent I've not been to preach around the world. I place demand on the oil of my ordination. Your uncle must die. Who has invoked spirit from the sea to fight you? Because I see a project you started doing, but the project is hanging. You couldn't do anything. I'm seeing a bare empty land. You could not establish a project on that land, and you cannot sell the land. I've seen over 20 cars. I've seen them covered with darkness. Carry more. I'm going to pray. Do not allow me. Do not allow me. Do not allow me, Jesus, to go empty-handed. Do not allow me. Do not allow me. Do not allow me, Jesus, to go empty-handed. You will not go empty-handed tonight. I command that wicked uncle of yours who ate your bread, drank your water, your money, they decided to do evil. In 7 days, you will hear that he's dead. Power. I remove the evil garment. Power from your cars. I command them to begin to sell like fire. I command days and opportunity open for you. I command straight release. Stretch your hands. I'm praying. Whoever
flooded your life with darkness. I, Joshua Talena, I raise a prophetic voice. I command that darkness removed from your life. I command that darkness removed from your life. From your life, I break that evil embargo in the name of Jesus. Locus capiata, I break that spell. 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 I break that spell.
Take your seat. Lift up your hands. Whoever sends any unbroken curse, stretch your hand. Let me pray. Say unbroken curse.
Unbroken curse.
I don't know where you're coming from.
I don't know where you're coming from.
And I don't know how you got here.
And I don't know how you got here.
To influence my atmosphere.
To influence my atmosphere.
And I say to you.
But I say to you.
Christ has redeemed me.
Christ has redeemed me.
From the curse.
From the curse.
I'm no longer cursed.
I'm no longer cursed.
So that the blessings of Abraham.
So that the blessings of Abraham.
May come upon me.
May come upon me.
I stand on the strength of the blessing.
I stand on the strength of the blessing.
And I terminate the curse.
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 I saw five people plotting your death. Being led by your sister. In the covens of witches. I'm coming to you. Some things I want to say, they are so private, so deep. I saw your daughter Amanda, her life is surrounded with a mystery. A man is working against her glory. I will tell you some things I am seeing.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
I'm seeing another person called Comfort. Comfort. This Comfort has a call of God. There is a mighty hand of God on Comfort. But of what use is that hand when Comfort's life does not embrace testimony in certain areas? Comfort, come to me. Something is wrong and somebody did it to you. Anything you try to do about marriage always end wrong. Bring that up. Anything you try to do about marriage end up wrong. There is a killer that follows you. There is a scatterer that follows you. I've seen it in the spiritual. Please bring those two people in white. Let them sit here. I just saw a prophecy about them. Let them sit in the second row. Put them there. Second row here. Put them here. Okay, keep them. You can put them here. That's okay. That's okay. That's okay. Sit. Push, sir. Push in this way. God bless you. God bless you. Thank you. Anytime you marry, something goes wrong. I've seen a man, they call him David. I'm hearing David Udochi. That man got married and this evil personality followed him and killed him. He killed him. Anything she touched about marriage, they kill it. It's not ordinary. I see an evil personality following her. The Lord said, pray for her. Pray for her. I'm seeing a child crying and it looks like he bear my name. I'm hearing Joshua. I'm hearing Joshua. I'm hearing Joshua. I'm hearing Joshua. The Lord said, transfer your anointing on Joshua. Hold me, Joshua. Jesus. Preserve this life. Give him the anointing to squash the enemy. The battles that almost swallow your mother, receive the mandate. Joshua, 7 years from now, you begin to prophesy. I put the seed of the Spirit upon you.
Amen.
Stand up, I need to pray for you. What is happening to you? It happened to your sister. I've seen a sister of yours in Europe.
Yes,
she, her husband walked away and came back. I saw him left, and I saw him come back. And I saw that they want to scatter them again. I've seen a man in South Africa. Do you know anybody there? They want to scatter that man again. I've seen a man coming to you from that area. Guy, your case is so deep and secretive. If I go deeper, I don't know how you will feel, but I have to stop. I'll talk to you one-on-one because it's so deep. It's so deep because by maturity, there are things I don't like saying openly before everybody. Because who am I trying to show up for? Who is John? Who did this to you? I've seen a woman by your side. 8 months pregnant.
Hey, cool.
She's 8 months, 2 weeks, 5 hours, 2 seconds. How many months, madam? Must die.
Amen.
Look at me. There's a mighty hand of God on you. From the womb you have been called, but you don't understand your life. You don't understand your life, sir. Jesus. Stretch your hand towards me, sir. Say, my father, my father.
My father, my father.
I saw an angel run and gave you a mantle and your wife. He says it's a mantle of growth. I see a congregation. I see a people. You've been following my teachings for some years. Right from Hyderabad that you heard about till now. From India. The Lord is giving you a mega ministry in Atlanta. A big ministry of thousands of Asians.
Amen.
They are going to come in their numbers.
Amen.
They will abandon the shrine of Hindu.
Amen.
He said, I will give you prophetic anointing.
Amen.
And the anointing of miracles. As I lay my hands on you, says the Lord, you will begin to prophesy.
Amen.
Your eyes will be open.
Amen.
He said, woman, I gave you a great intercessory ministry. He said, I am taking you to another level. I heard him say, don't be discouraged. Don't give up on the work that I have put in your hands. 3 years from now, you will come to say, thank you, man of God. You spoke a word concerning my life, and I held to it. The Lord said, I am the one that backed that ministry. I will blow it and expand it, and I will cause you to multiply, says the Spirit of the Lord. He said, the giftings of the Holy Ghost is coming upon you right now. I take the mantle of my life. Every unbroken curse. Called of God. May the enemy want you to serve God with reproach, with shame, with no testimony. If I be a prophet, that spell is broken.
Amen.
Break!
Amen.
Break! Baby, hear the word of the Lord. 3 weeks time, come out.
Amen.
And you will only trouble her for 15 minutes.
Amen.
And you will come out like the Hebrew woman.
Amen.
Powers holding this man. Break! Stretch your hand. Let me try to round up because something is heavy. I may not be able to continue. Your prophecy is getting stronger for me. Stretch your hands. I prophesy. I didn't like that what you said. I prophesy. The curse is broken.
Yeah.
I say it 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 is broken.
Yeah.
Take your seat. The last one for tonight. Because tonight is a mini night vigil. How many of you are aware of that? It's a mini, but before 12 we'll stop. I'm telling you, it's a mini, but we'll stop. It's supposed to be a night vigil all night. That I want to use one stone to kill 3 birds. You will go back and return by 11 tomorrow. I'm going to have 11 to 1 p.m. service. 1:30, if you come 1:30, you'll meet me at the airport. I'm already on my way to Houston. Is that okay? You'll catch me at the airport. Is that okay? Stretch your hands. I declare, no curse is permitted to operate. Take your seat. Number 3 spirit that fights your prophecy is a mature spirit. I remember I mentioned a little when I came to Case Church. A mature spirit. Someone say mature.
Mature.
Mature he doesn't rise. Mature he doesn't make it. Mature. Mature. Mature that he doesn't get married. Mature that he does not break through. Mature. 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 Mature spirit. Matthew 27. Verse 60 to 64. Measure spirit. Men of you. There is a wicked line that is drawn. They say, we will make sure you don't cross. That spirit shall die.
Yeah.
When measure spirit is in oppression, prophecy is hindered. 62. Let's have 62. Let's read it together. I want to go. Now, the next day that followed the day of the preparation, the chief priest and Pharisee came together to Pilate. Continue, sir. Saying, sir, we remember that this deceiver said, while he was yet alive, after 3 days, I will rise again. Someone said, that is a prophecy. Someone said, that is a prophecy.
That's the prophecy.
Now, the enemy wants to fight the prophecy. How did he want to fight the prophecy? Look at the verse 64. Command therefore that the sepulchre be made sure until the third day. Lest his disciple come by night and steal him away and say to the people, he is risen from the dead. So the last error shall be worse than the first. Verse 65. Finally, what did he say? Pilate said unto them, you have a watch. Go your way. Make it as sure as you can. Make sure it doesn't happen. Make sure that rascal does not resurrect. How many of you know that our Christianity is based on the dead and the resurrection? If Christ be not risen from the dead, we are most men most miserable. The reason for our salvation is the resurrection of Jesus. That's what makes us different from Muslims, makes us different from Hindus, makes us different from Mormons, all kinds of religions of the world. But hear me, son of God, the enemy fought the very testimony of the church, which is the resurrection of Jesus. So, what did he do? Pilate gave them 56 soldiers to guide the tomb. Pilate gave them a stone, massive stone, to put on the mouth of the tomb. Jesus had multiple enemies so that his prophecy won't come to pass. If he resurrects from the dead, the grave will keep him. If you want to come out, the stone will limit him. Even if he managed to come out, the soldiers are there to kill him again. To kill him again. Men of you under the sound of my voice, you have multiple attacks. You escape this, you fight this. You escape this, you fight this. You escape this, you fight this. It's a mixture spirit. Many started nursing school but can't finish. It's a mixture spirit. Many started processing their papers. Till death, they can't get it. Others came before them and got it. Because as a mixture spirit, I said, you'll be a wanderer in this land. There's a monkeyous and a vagabondic spirit that pursues. It's a mixture spirit. Mixture spirit. Mess your spirit. Today, I arrest that spirit. 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 That is why no matter what you do about your relationship, it doesn't work. Because I said, make sure spirit that makes sure that your marriage relationship does not work. My friend picked one lady in a church, and he picked her just the way I picked this woman. He said, you tried to marry 5 times. It didn't work. She said, yes. He said, the 5th one was on your wedding day. You were wearing your white gown, heading to church. When your phone rang and you got a text, when you opened the text, it was your man who sent you a text. And you asked your bridesmaid to read the text. And bridesmaid read, and the text said, stupid girl, idiot. Who will marry a person like you and a foolish woman? I have changed my mind. I will never marry you. God forbid for me to marry you. As I'm talking, I'm on my way to the Francophone country. As you are going to the church, go and marry yourself. And the lady fainted in the car. She was in the hospital for 2 weeks in coma. She revived back. When she revived, they brought her back home. That is the 5th time a man was breaking her heart. I'm telling you, this woman, if I don't kill somebody, I'm not called. You, if I don't kill somebody. They have put a mature spirit on you that you will not enjoy marriage. I'm coming to your matter. Sit down. I'm coming to your matter. And I'm seeing cases like this all over this building. Where there is a vow, there's an oath over your life. That you will serve God but no reflection of serving God. You will come to church but nothing to show. You will fast and pray and develop ulcer. But your Christianity is like putting water in the basket. This girl fainted. She recovered her in the hospital, came back to her house, but she never left church. She continued. Why? Because the Bible said, when the spirit of the ruler of thy city rises up against you, leave not your place. Do not leave your place. When your enemy is fighting, don't leave your church. Don't leave your man of God simply because your prophecy is delayed. The Bible said, when the spirit of the ruler of thy city rises up against you, don't leave. Stay. You need stay in power. Because having done all to stand, stand. Because you are closer to your miracle than when you first speak. The lady came to service and continued serving God. 2 weeks after, my friend entered the church and picked her like I picked this woman. He said, that day you fainted. She said, yes. He said, right now as I'm talking to you, you are going through your menstrual cycle. She said, yes. He said, this morning you changed your menstrual pad. She said, yes. Where did you drop your menstrual pad? Say, in the dustbin. He said, go back there. You will find it. And when you don't see it, ask your mother of your menses. Ask your mother. The lady did not wait for service to close. She left. If it is you, will you say? No, wrong. She went straight to the dustbin, looked for her menstrual pad. It wasn't there. She entered the parlor. Mama, mommy, where are you? Mommy was not in the parlor. Mommy. So she opened the bedroom door. Guess what she saw? She met her mother licking her menstrual pad. Why? The mother had gone to a juju priest to stop the girl from getting married. Why? The mother said her father died when she was 3 years. So she labored and suffered to train the girl to university. And now the girl is working in an oil company. So this girl is going to get married and forget to take care of her. So it is her turn to take care of her like she took care of her when she was small. So he said, Baba, stop her marriage until I'm dead before she marries. So Baba said to her, the only way her marriage will stop is for her to be leaking her menstrual cycle. The mother said, you remember my daughter, anywhere you travel, I cry to follow you. All, especially when I know it's around your monthly cycle, because I'm targeting your menstrual path. Because that is the internal punishment I am giving to begin to lick your menstrual path to keep you with that marriage. Now, what is happening to her? She thought the devil is fighting her out there, but there was a menstrual spirit in her house. She's insulting the men, calling them names for breaking her heart, but she did not know that there is a spirit that is mysteriously fighting her. Why is it that everywhere you go, they find you in that office? Every day you are resigning, moving from one job to another like a monkey. It's a monkey spirit. It's a vagabondic spirit. You don't stay in one job. You jump from job one to job two. Job three, you change cities like changing rappers. You change environment like changing rappers. You even change church. You change church like changing rappers. My friend, it's more than the church. It's more than where you work. There is a mature spirit fighting your prophecy. And can I shock you, sir? The devil does not fight any man that does not have a future. Mature spirit is not after people that don't have prophecy. The reason why mature spirit comes after you is the prophecy over your head. There is a word over your life that God said concerning you, and that is what the devil is after. Why did he want to stop Jesus? Not because the devil hates Jesus. He hates the prophecy. After 3 days, I will rise again. That was a prophetic word over the head of Jesus. And the devil made sure that that thing did not come to pass. Then I came to announce to somebody, there is a power call. The power of the Holy Ghost. The Bible says on the resurrection morning, the power of the Holy Ghost descended on the tomb. The angel rolled away the stone and sat upon the stone, and the soldiers went under the anointing and were as dead. 56 soldiers went into a state of comatose and they passed out, and the Son of God resurrected. Can I talk to somebody? If they cannot stop Jesus from resurrecting, if that same spirit that raises Jesus from the dead dwelleth in you, that same spirit also shall quicken your marriage, quicken your body, quicken your business, quicken your life, quicken your destiny, quicken your finances. Can I talk to somebody here? I speak resurrection. I speak resurrection. Financial breakthroughs. Marital breakthroughs. I speak open heavens over your life. The devil is a liar. Any force that limited you, today I command that force to catch fire. Any altars fighting you to make sure that there is no testimony in your life, I set that altar on fire. Any power fighting your glory, I set it on fire. By the power of the Holy Ghost, I move your life from the backside to the front line, from a nobody to a somebody, from a non-entity to a some entity, from a coincidence to God's incident, from rejection to projection, from sanctification to glorification. The stone the builders have rejected, after today, it shall become a chief cornerstone. Somebody's level is changing. Somebody's destiny is changing. No power can hold you down. It was not possible for death to hold him. They cannot keep you down. They cannot keep your marriage down. They cannot keep your finance down. I release you now. I release your business. I release your marriage. Somebody shall I receive. I release your breakthroughs. I release your favor. Something is breaking. Something is opening. Somebody shout, I receive. Jump on your feet, 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 shout, I receive. Somebody shout in the name of Jesus. Prophecy must come to pass.
Must come to pass.
Shout it louder, my prophecy.
My prophecy
must come to pass.
Must come to pass.
Say every menstrual spirit.
Every menstrual spirit.
Fighting my prophetic word. You are a liar. Catch fire. Catch fire. Catch fire. Who has a prophecy? Who is carrying a word? Has God ever spoken to you since you became born again? Have you read the Bible and saw a light that became your word? If you are there, stand on your feet and get serious right now.
We are about to pray into the womb of the Spirit. The rain of prophetic is about to fall. The heavens are opening unto us. Every mature man and woman, don't allow your children to stop you. Stand up on your feet and get serious. Clap your hand and begin to pray. My prophecy.
Of the Lord said, no more broken relationships.
Amen.
Amen. Natasha, come to me. No more broken relationships.
Amen.
There is a spirit that fights your relationships and fight your finances. The Lord said, you have come to your robot, which is Atlanta. He said, move no more. Stay in this land. I will bless you.
Amen.
I'm seeing a young man coming. Forget about everyone around you. I'm seeing another one coming. And this time around, it shall be right.
Amen.
I look at it, I saw the road September. And I saw in the realm of the spirit, an angel went forth and brought the man to you.
Amen.
I saw one of the glorious weddings in your family. Because in your family is difficult for marriage. It's a mature spirit. When the Lord says you will break the chain.
Amen.
And the glory of your life will manifest.
Amen.
Pay it.
Thank you, Jesus.
Pastor, get me your wife. I've seen a mature spirit in her family. I'm seeing a mature spirit in her family. Open your hands, everybody.
Thank you, Jesus.
Say, mature spirit.
Mature spirit.
You are a liar.
You're a liar.
Man, there's a mature spirit fighting you. I'm in Jamaica. I'm seeing something. I'm not only seeing you, I'm seeing another person by your side. I'm seeing like the same father, different mother. I'm seeing the road calling.
Yes, sir.
The Lord said, touch Colleen's womb.
My God,
and touch her womb.
Thank you, Jesus.
There's a collective battle. there is a menstrual spirit that this is a that want to deny these people their glory.
Yes.
I'm seeing a man called Michael. He is wondering what is happening to his wife. But the Lord said it was a natural spirit that should kill it, because you are carrying prophecy. You are carrying prophecy heavy. Man, if you don't carry your 3 children, I will throw my Bible. If you don't carry your 4 children, I will throw my Bible. Stand up.
Thank you, Jesus.
If I be a man of God,
hallelujah,
every natural spirit,
Jesus,
planted in your marriage,
hallelujah,
is over.
Amen.
Keep on the floor. Let the angels walk on her. Mama of the house,
yes,
highly gifted,
amen,
with the word and with songs. You are no less anointed, man. It's just that you need a grace that I carry. Even if it's only you I came for,
thank you, Jesus,
says the Lord,
thank you, Jesus,
it's already a success.
Amen.
The children are in the spirit realm, but the natural spirit wouldn't allow them to arrive. The Lord says it is over.
Thank you, Jesus.
Keep on the floor. Keep on.
Thank you, Jesus.
My friend was a man of God, believing God for 20 years. I came up, Reverend Akoria, spoke. Bam. The woman took him.
Amen.
The Lord says, I should tell you, that thing you are trying to do, do it. That thing you are trying to write, the Lord says, you want to go, but you are afraid. Because it is as if you have done it several times. I'm seeing something like a nursing, something like medicine. I am seeing your uncle in the grave. And I'm seeing his children. And I'm seeing them doing something, and you are seeing that thing. You had a dream, not once, not twice. You are with a laptop. They will come and take the laptop from you. Your laptop lost in the dream, not once, not twice. Your laptop is in the hands of your uncle's children. Come to me. Your laptop. Is the last exam you write.
Yeah.
The Lord said, you have served Apostle John C. Suleiman.
Yes.
I saw his spirit upon you. Yes. His spirit will not allow them to kill you, because they have planned to kill you. They have dug your grave in the village. But you just refuse to die. Because I see the spirit of Apostle around you.
Amen.
I recover your laptop.
Amen.
I recover your glory.
Amen.
I recover your laptop.
Amen.
I recover your glory.
Amen.
I recover your laptop.
Amen.
I recover your glory.
Amen.
I recover your laptop.
Yes.
I recover your glory.
Yes.
Pray it.
Yes. Thank you, Jesus.
The Lord said, a young man that came from Ghana, your mother, if she can be patient, something better is coming. If she go ahead with him, she will enjoy the marriage for a season,
that the guy is under the spirit of brokerage. There's a curse of poverty. And your mom is fighting battles that will not allow her prosper. If she joined force with another man who has been stopped from prospering, what is that? Suffering. I will talk to you and your mom.
Thank you, Jesus.
Jesus.
The only one for me.